Hi everyone, this is Venus Brown. Today I'm going to be doing a discussion of the season finale of House of the Dragon called The Black Queen. Just so everybody knows, I am going to start this with a discussion of episode 9 because I did not do a full discussion for episode 9. So I will start with that and then I will add a title card after that to where it is switching from my discussion of episode 9 to the discussion of episode 10, the finale. Doing this in the living room because somebody is in my room right now, so hopefully it doesn't get too loud because a lot of times there is background noise from other people in the house. If you like this video, please click the like button. If you want more content, click subscribe. If you click that little bell and click all, then you'll get more content notifications. If you want to hear about more of my plans for what I am doing now that the season is over, please stay tuned till the end of my discussion, and I will give you a little update. So let's get started with the beginning of episode 9. We start, the castle is pretty much quiet, and very few people seem to be up except for the staff, and you see a young boy running through the castle and gets the attention for the handmaid for Alicent. Of course, Queen Alicent goes and tells them about her revelation that she got from King Viserys the night before, where she insists that the king had told her that he wants Aegon to be on the throne, which we know ourselves that that's not really what he was saying, but Queen Alicent is going to take it the way that she took it because that's what she wants to hear. And they just proceed to go on about their business, like, okay, let's continue on with our treason, because that's what they had been planning on doing all along, apparently without Alicent's consent or knowledge. However, I still feel like Alicent is playing dumb with a lot of this stuff. Like, she should know better. She probably did know better. She goes ahead and makes them reiterate to try to explain it to her. And you can see how frustrated she is. So even if she did sort of know what was going on, you can still see that she's maybe a little upset even that she was left out of all this and that these people were all plotting behind her back. So it wouldn't have mattered what she did. They were still going to do whatever the heck they wanted in spite of her direction. And you have two sides with two kinds of different directions in this situation where Otto Hightower wants to kind of conceal what's going on within the Red Keep and within King's Landing, and to assassinate a bunch of people so that the information doesn't get out and so that they automatically eliminate some of those that would contest their treason. Whereas Alicent wants to use more restraint. She does not want certain people dead, especially Rhaenyra, who she insists that there is no way on this earth that King Viserys ever would have been okay with his daughter being killed. She at least got them to stay their hand in that scenario. She wanted to at least try to appeal to Rhaenyra in order to get her to maybe see some sort of reason in order to take some hopefully favorable terms that Rhaenyra might be a little more willing to take. And honestly, I thought that would never work in the first place, but we see in the next episode what she does to try to pull at Rhaenyra's heartstrings. With these two separate sides and the two different ways that Alicent and Otto Hightower were trying to approach the situation, you also had a similar contrasting of ways that they were trying to deal with finding Aegon and getting him on the throne. I can't say exactly what Otto was trying to do, that he was trying to get Aegon on the throne before anyone could notify Rhaenyra. I think he also wanted to just have them killed so they wouldn't even be a player on the board. Alicent wants to find Aegon, have a little talk with him because she knows He's a good for nothing creep and he has no business on the throne. Notify the entire realm that he is being made king and have this big coronation. Do things more open and upstanding. That's the difference that I'm assuming. Otto wanted to conceal things more, hide them from anybody that would be against them, and kill off anybody that would be against them, whereas Alicent wanted to take a more restrained approach and appeal to the other side's better nature, try to make terms and peace with them, and to let everyone in the realm know that this was happening and give her son a big coronation. So both of them send out parties to go and look for this kid who is drunk, who doesn't want to be found, who does not want to be on the throne. And they have to go through all this mess of seeing the kind of really unsavory, nasty character that they are really trying to put on the throne while they're trying to find him. They can't find him because he has been kind of hidden in a more safe and secure location and taken off the streets, but he's drunk off of his ass as usual. We get to see images of these children that are made to fight with their freaking nails filed down and their teeth filed down to make them look more formidable, is how they're described. We also get to see this young child in the background who apparently is one of Aegon's possibly many bastard children. And it's kind of ironic to me, the big stink that Alicent always made about Rhaenyra's children being bastards. Big stink she made when she found out that Rhaenyra was having sex out of wedlock, yet she has this son who is just creating bastards all over town and doesn't care at all. I know the situation is different because he does not have these children in the line of succession or anything like that, but it's still kind of hypocritical. And especially since she's still insisting on pushing him on the throne while rejecting Rhaenyra's succession to the throne. We have a few other themes that occur in this episode that I wanted to address, such as the people who did attempt to stand up to the treason that was occurring, and the people that attempted to make a great escape, some of which succeeded, and some of which unfortunately either met their demise or were locked up. Of course, that first one in the council meeting, when he tried to speak up and insist that there is no way that Viserys would have decided that Aegon was going to be king. He's known him his whole life. He's older than any of them in there. He's known Viserys longer than anyone in there. And there's no way that this would have happened. So to shut him up, Crispin, Alicent's guard dog, goes and slams his head into their little eyeball thing or whatever. I don't know what it's called. He is bleeding out all over the table and they just leave him there because they don't want to take him out of there before this meeting is finished and before they've laid all the groundwork to get everything in place to put Aegon on the throne. So that was very freaking disturbing. The next we have Eric. So I believe there was Arik and Eric, and Eric is the one that decided to leave. He had seen enough. He was like, this is disgusting. This is treason. This guy has no business being on the throne. I need to get the fuck out of here. So he goes, gets his shit together. He goes and breaks Rhaenys out of her locked room that she's been locked in this whole time, and helps her to escape. Now, of course, they get separated in the fiasco, but that's how we end up with the grand finale we have for that episode when Rhaenys makes her big escape. And we don't see Eric after that in this episode, but we'll see him later in the next episode. Then, while Otto Hightower had called all these lords that were nearby into the throne room to make them swear obeisance to this new not king, because he hadn't been sworn in yet. There were a very small handful of people that stayed standing when he asked them to bend the knee for Aegon. You see him take two of them away, and then the other lord kneels down and plays along, but later on he tries to get out. Unfortunately, because of Laerys and his conniving ass, he lets Otto know what's going on. They capture him, and we see him later on hanging from the rafters. And of course, I think we should bow our heads for all our fallen heroes who were willing to stand up to treason but didn't make it out of the Red Keep alive. All right, we get this big, fabulous coronation because Allison has finally had a chance to talk to her son and try to convince him that he needs to do this, that he's going to have to do this, and that Rhaenyra will have him killed if he doesn't anyway. And she appeases him with the dagger, but whatever. They have their coronation, and Rhaenys is in the coronation because of the split up that happens between her and Eric. And she sees the whole thing go on, but she still wants to get to Meleys. And she still wants to get the heck out of there. So while they are in the process of crowning the king, she exits stage left, goes down under the building where the coronation is happening, gets her dragon, and of course she can't get him out without killing a whole bunch of peasants and everything in the process. So she takes him out, kills a bunch of peasants, turns the dragon around, and before she leaves the building, she brings the dragon all the way up to the front of this coronation where the entire chain of command is standing and all the royal people are standing, stealing the throne and committing treason. And I just keep yelling, fire, use the fire and get the fuck out, use the fire and get the fuck out. And I have to say, there is a reason that I was so freaking out about her even being there and about her being on the dragon and not getting out right away, because I can't say a lot of it. I will just say that there are things that happen later on in Fire and Blood that were making me very nervous that they were making me nervous that they were making a change to the book. Would have made me very upset and could go very wrong. So that's where my concern was. That's why I was freaking out and telling her to get the fuck out of there. I was really worried. So, and there is this reality that, God, if she had just yelled her chorus and lit these people up, all of this would have been done. The treason would have been done. They could have freaking crowned Rhaenyra. They could have maybe somehow convinced the kingdom to accept Rhaenyra without a giant war. We don't know that. It might have still happened anyway. But so much death and heartbreak and war possibly could have been avoided if she had done that. But we all know there's no show without that. And this is Westeros. You kill a king or queen, you kill your kin, you are massively looked down upon, and they will treat you like you're cursed, and you will feel like you're cursed. So I can definitely see why she would not want any part in that. And then her reaction later on in the next episode definitely gives us a better inclination of why she did not do that. Before we move on to episode 10, the finale of House of the Dragon, I think we should also bow our heads and take a moment of silence in memory of King Viserys, who has died. Okay. And no, I am not religious. I used to be a very progressive religious person on the Christian side. I am not anymore. I am what you would call agnostic. I don't believe one way or another that I would know or that anyone else can really know for sure. And now it is time to move on to episode 10, the grand finale of House of the Dragon. And we start out with almost a reflection of the previous episode where the castle is empty and nobody seems to really know what has just happened and things are fairly quiet. And we see Rhaenyra talking to her son, Lyseris, who is very, very upset and frustrated. He has now been made heir to Driftmark. He explains how he is no good for the position, how easily he gets sick, and it wouldn't make any sense for him to lead a bunch of people that basically spend their lives and livelihood working on a ship. So he doesn't get it. And of course, Rhaenyra tries to help soften it and help him understand that you don't have to be perfect at this, that your parents are here to help mold you into the person that can do this kind of work. And he's like, "But I'm not you, Mom." She's like, "How do you mean?" And he proceeds to say, "I'm not perfect." And she's like, "Oh, sweet child. The last thing I am is perfect. I had a lot of help. I had a lot of people supporting me and paving the way for me." That's not exactly how she said it, but you get my drift. And while she's having this important discussion, Rhaenys comes in, of course, being the bearer of bad news. Not only is your father dead, but your friend, Alicent, has usurped the throne, placed her horrific son on the throne, and crowned him king. And I'm pretty damn sure that they are going to be coming for you and your children. You should really get the hell out of here. This news, of course, is very hard for Rhaenyra, and Rhaenyra is pregnant, and she starts having preterm labor pains. She starts to go into straight up labor, and it is too early. I don't know how early it is according to the show, and I've already addressed that in the book it was much too early. But either way, the baby's coming too early, but she is still going through labor. And you can see while the men are in another room making their plans on how they're gonna proceed in this situation, you can hear Rhaenyra in the background going through her labor pains, screaming and moaning, and every now and then they'll cut to an image of the dragon also screaming in pain from the pain that Rhaenyra is going through. We also have a scene where Rhaenys goes out to tell Jacerys and Lucerys that they need to come to their mother's aid because she has gone into labor and they need to go and speak to her. They go in and she explains to them what has happened. They can easily see she is in labor. She tells Jacerys on the way out that no plans should be made without her consent and that he is now the heir to the throne, that he needs to get this information to the people that are discussing the plans moving forward. I think at this point they were trying to figure out who they already knew would be on their side, or maybe an extra nudge in order to get them on their side. And Daemon was insisting that he was going to ride his dragon over to one of these places to take care of that when Jacerys walks in the room and insists that no, Rhaenyra insists that nobody is to do anything until she is not abed anymore. It looks at first like Daemon is going to kind of ignore him and tells one of the other lords to go ahead and send out the ravens like he asked. But I think it was actually just, okay, we're gonna proceed with sending out the ravens. Because he did not get on the dragon and go out and do what he said. Instead, he tells Jacerys to follow him, that he's going to show him an example of how you actually gain loyalty, at least Daemon's way of gaining loyalty, which for him was to use his dragon to scare and threaten these knights. Ask them some questions about their oaths, remind them of the oaths that they made, and ensure that they understand that it is Rhaenyra that is supposed to be in the line of succession, not Aegon. And then give them a choice. And I was like, well, that's not really a choice because you're using the dragon. They know. They either go along with what you say or they die. But then he also adds this caveat that if you lie, if you say that you are going to follow this oath, and then later on you become a turncloak and you break your oath, then you will die screaming. So I guess in that way, there's sort of a choice. It's more like you either take death now for being a traitor, you take death later for being a traitor later, or you swear your oath again and you stick to your oath. So I'll give it to him, I'll let him have it, but I still think it's not a real choice. And then we see more of Rhaenyra's harrowing delivery. Very painful, and she has this war going on within herself. The helpers are telling her to please let them help her, and she's not having any of that. She just wants this out. She just wants it done. I mean, I think at that point she probably knew that there was no way that the baby was going to live, but you can't proceed with much of anything while you're trying to deliver a stillborn baby. She keeps going and she keeps pushing and screaming, and then I think you see the water break, and then she slowly manages to push and pull the baby out, and the baby is stillborn, which is really sad and really gruesome, but she did a phenomenal job of acting that whole scene out. One of the other things I want to talk about is grief and how this show has done a decent job at showing the different ways that grief can be expressed in different people. The people handle grief in their own different ways. So you see Daemon on the beach by himself going through this. And I think part of this is a bit of a trigger reaction after the last birthing struggles that he experienced with Laena, when she pulled herself out of the birthing room, went all the way to her dragon and made the dragon incinerate her. This may just be another reflection of those same bad memories and knowing that this was not going to go well, and his inability to really show his feelings and show his grief in front of people after he has already been through so much. But I don't know. I can't speak to the mind of Daemon Targaryen or what all he was experiencing, but they at least do show him silently out on the beach, grieving in his own way. While you see Rhaenyra up in her room, she probably needs that kind of love and support, but she is screaming and crying. Later on, you see Corlys wake from his feverish state, and Rhaenys is there, and he starts to chastise her about falling asleep on the job, and she proceeds to tell him, "You left me. You left me when I needed you more than ever. When we had lost our children, and you just left me to deal with all this pain and grief on my own." And so that was her way of dealing with this grief. And then he proceeds to tell her that he had lost everything. Like, he needed to get away and he needed to grieve because he lost everything. And she's like, "These were our children. We lost, and I needed you here, and you were not here. You abandoned me." So really, you've got all those modes of grief. And then you also see in the previous episode with Queen Alicent, when Viserys died, in spite of all the shit that she's kind of done at Otto's behest, she still seemed to really be loving and devoted to that man. So, in spite of how bad and decrepit and close to death he had been for so long, she was still upset. She still was very sad, still grieving and crying, and in her own way. After Rhaenyra gives birth to this stillborn child, they go through the funeral services, burning the child, and while they are in the process of doing this, Eric comes in, lets them know that he is a friend, that he is not a foe, pulls out the crown which he has brought so that they can now crown Rhaenyra. And we get to see this lovely scene with all of these people in front of her, bending the knee in support of her being the new queen, except for Rhaenys. But Rhaenys comes around later. And like I said in one of my previous reactions, I don't think Rhaenys felt that she could take a side yet at that point. So she needed to get to where she was willing to take a side, and she could figure out where her family was being positioned. Either way, it was a very beautiful, emotional scene that I was very glad to see. And it also showed like a contrast between the two crownings. So the one with Aegon, that where they forced all of the people into this dragon pit to watch this humongous coronation of Aegon, whereas Rhaenyra's is much smaller and, none of the pomp and circumstance really, but it was still a very beautiful ceremony. And then we find out that Otto Hightower is there. He has graced them with his ugly presence, and they have to go and deal with this man again, who has come with peaceful terms in order to try to appease Queen Alicent and appease Rhaenyra by saying that they tried before any war occurs. But he insists that he has to only talk to Rhaenyra and ask where Rhaenyra is, and Rhaenyra swoops in on her dragon, being her badass self. The terms of peace from Otto, proceeds to take the pin of the hand from him and insists that he is no fucking hand of the king. And you can see that she's pretty much completely has no agreement with any of this. Like, he's completely delusional if he thinks that she's going to take this stance. She is going to take these peace terms at all. And then Otto hands her this paper. And it took me a while to figure out what the paper was, but it was a page from that history book that Alicent and Rhaenyra were trying to study from early in the season. And so, in that way, Alicent is trying to reach Rhaenyra from this position of they used to be these good friends who really had this love for each other. And to try to reach her there and get her to hopefully be a little more likely to agree to their terms, which does seem to work, but she tells Otto that she will have an answer for him on the morrow. So then they can proceed to go back to planning. And now that we've already talked a little bit about Corlys and Rhaenys' grief, we should also talk about their discussion. From the very beginning, I've seen Rhaenys as a person who is maybe a bit of a realist. She knows because of her experience, because of the way things have gone in her life, she knows that the realm is a very awful place and that there are certain expectations they have of females, and those females don't fit for much of the kingdom leading the Iron Throne. She knows certain things about her children that her husband wasn't willing to acknowledge. She knows certain things about Rhaenyra's children that her dad wasn't willing to acknowledge, and on and on and on. I see her as kind of a realist. I don't think she supports these things. I think it's that she knows that this is how it is, and she knows how you have to be in order to deal with it. And to me, she is like a good example of how you should be if you want to deal with that kind of stuff in a semi-healthy way. But Rhaenyse is also a human being, and she knows that when her son died, the circumstances of his death looked very suspect and made it very likely that Rhaenyra had something to do with it. She doesn't know that her son is actually alive. So what she does know, that's going to make any mother feel very freaking angry and hateful towards this person that you think probably had something to do with your child's death. And I don't blame her, not one tiny bit. But I think at this point, she's getting to a position where she is starting to see Rhaenyra more as a person who actually should be on the throne, and that some people can support, and who is trying to do the right thing for the realm than maybe she had previously. And if you remember back at the beginning of the series, when we first see her interacting with Rhaenyra, I think this whole idea of Rhaenyra is now in this position that I should have been in at one point, and I was turned down because the realm basically rejected me. And here's this young kid, this teenager, who's just been handed the same thing that I was supposed to receive. She's naive. She doesn't get what she's getting into, and the realm is never going to accept it. But I think as both of them have grown older and she has gotten to know Rhaenyra a little better, even with all of the awful shit that she suspects Rhaenyra of, I think she is starting to see Rhaenyra more as the firm fighter that needs to be on the throne than what she expected her to be before. So when Corlys tells her that she was right from the beginning, that he should have given up on all these ideas of reigning on the Iron Throne, and that he reached too far, they should just take their grandchildren and go back to Driftmark and live a happy, loving retirement away from all this war and nonsense and hatred and all of that, reminds him, your grandchildren are in the line of succession, that they will be in danger. He proceeds to yell at her about how everything Rhaenyra touches gets destroyed, and Rhaenys actually sticks up for her. You know, while all these men are out here plotting and they're ready to push our entire realm headlong into war, she is the only one showing any kind of constraint. She is the only one that is actually showing some level-headedness and trying to stop us from getting into like one of the worst wars of our history. So that does convince Corlys that he is going to go ahead and back Rhaenyra, that they cannot let this Hightower treason stand. And when he goes to tell Rhaenyra that he is going to support her, he also brings her the news that during the situation that got him into his illness, he actually managed to gain control of the stepstones. So now his fleet has the ability to control all of the influx from those waterways over there by King's Landing. So with his support and his fleet support, they can keep stuff from getting into King's Landing and actually give the Blacks a fighting chance in this war that they really had almost no chance of winning before then. Not without using the dragons and lighting up everybody. And like Rhaenyra said, she doesn't want to rule over a realm of ash and bone. But during this planning session, they figure out where they're sending ravens, who they're trying to appease, and some of the dragons that are going to be sent out along with their riders. And two of the dragon riders are going to be Rhaenyra's children. And I knew because of the books that one of them was gonna die. I just didn't know exactly how they were gonna do it. I knew that was coming, and my stomach was all tied up in knots the whole time. Viserys goes to Storm's End to try to appeal to Lord Boris, and when he gets there, he sees Vhagar out in the yard, and he goes inside and sees that Aemon is there. So, of course, that just starts him on the wrong foot in the first place. But also, when Boris is finally given the terms and he gets the Maester to read the terms because he can't read them, he basically is like, look, Aemon here is giving me a marriage pact so that I can marry off one of my daughters. What do you got for me? And basically, all his notice was a reminder of the oath that had already been made. And he's like, that's, you need to go back to your mom and tell her, you can't just freaking expect me to come whenever you blow your whistle to go up against whatever foes that you have at hand. And of course, Aemon stops the kid as he's leaving, insisting that he should take his eye out in exchange for the eye that he lost during that fight that he had previously, which, like I've said in another reaction, he lost his eye in a fair fight, and that should be the end of it. I'm sure that's not why how he feels about it. And I'm sure that the reaction that his mother had definitely spurred him to feel that he has the right to ask for an eye. But I feel like the whole situation that that fight occurred in, and the reality that he lost an eye in that fight, to me, was fair. And he did gain a dragon anyway. So I don't feel like anybody owes him another eye. I think it's ridiculous that after all this time, he's still insisting that the kid needs to give him an eye. And if that was his stance, then he should have requested it a long time ago. But either way, Lord Boris is like, no, you cannot be doing this under my roof. This kid came as an envoy. He is under my peace protections, and you can't be fighting under my roof. I'm not gonna have it. But then he sends the kid out. I really felt like, with the weather the way it was, with it being as late as it was, even though this unfortunate shit was going on between Jacaerys and Aemon, he should have requested that they both stay in his castle, that he get separate rooms far away from each other, somewhere in his castle, that they can stay in overnight until the weather gets better. Instead, he sends him out. And Aemon goes out and freaking proceeds to chase him down with his dragon. And I realize Aemon may have had no intention of killing that kid at all, but what he was doing was very dangerous and very, very stupid. If you have half a fucking brain cell in your head, you gotta know that when you are commanding a massive dragon like that, and your emotions are in an uproar, and you know that dragons feed off of your emotions, you know that they kind of feel your emotions, and the weather is bad, which is going to make them more skittish and more upset and more hard to control. You got to know that something like that could happen, especially when you're chasing this kid down with your dragon. Even though he may have had no intention on killing him at all, he should have known better. He should have known better. And I'm sorry, those kids have all had enough training on riding those dragons to understand that that kind of stuff should not be acceptable. And that those dragons are not able to be controlled that much, that they're going to just completely obey your every freaking command when you are upset and they are upset, the weather is horrible, and you are playing cat and mouse. with another dragon. And so he basically puts both dragons into fight or flight mode. And what do? Even when their riders are not commanding them to do things, they end up doing it. First, Eric's Dracarys all over Vhagar. And then you got Aemon trying to convince Vhagar not to go after him, but it's too freaking late by then. He's in freaking fight mode. And so he goes straight after the kid, flies up above him, dives down, and takes him out in one bite. And Aemon looks back like, oh, fuck, I screwed up. Yeah, you screwed up. You screwed up from the beginning when you first took that goddamn dragon up to have a freaking cat and mouse fight with this kid. You screwed up. That is all the discussion I have for the season finale. I think it was phenomenal. I know some people didn't like it. I don't care about the fact that it was leaked. I know some people do. I definitely didn't watch it early. I usually can't even watch these things on time, so I watched it late, as usual. Whatever happened, happened. I still thought the episode was really good. I thought it was a great finale. Could there have been things that were done differently this season? Sure. But I think overall, it was an excellent series. And I'm really, really looking forward to season two. I'm not going to talk a whole lot about what I'm expecting from season two. I know too much from the book. And I have done a lot of looking at some of the other videos and stuff from the show producers. So I don't want to really go into that stuff too much. But like I said in my last reaction video, this doesn't have to be over with. I have some plans. So now that House of the Dragon is over for the season, and we are not likely to see the second season until probably 2014, possibly the end of 2013, I was thinking that it would be nice to keep things going a little bit. And so my idea is that I will do a three-part rewatch of House of the Dragon season one. Okay. I will start with episode 1, 2, and 3, and the second part will be episode 4, 5, and 6, and then the last part will be episode 7 through 10. I will definitely set up the rewatch a little bit different than I have the discussions and reactions the first time around, but I am going to try to spread these out more. So it will not be a weekly thing. I think I will start my first rewatch video next week. So you can be expecting the video to be released sometime after about a week or so from now. After that, I plan to release each preceding part. And then I would really like to do a live stream for the entire season. I don't know exactly when I'll do that. But I'm figuring we can just kind of rehash some of the stuff that happened in the show, like some of the most exciting things, some of the most awesome things. If you have any input, put it in the comments and I can talk about it during the live stream. I will give you an update on exactly when I plan on doing that live stream during the third part to my rewatch video. And in the meantime, outside of House of the Dragon, I still have a couple more episodes of Handmaid's Tale to do reaction and discussion for. I am still doing reactions for The Crown and for Dairy Girls, and I will get back to more regular reactions of those now that House of the Dragon is over and Handmaid's is almost over. Until next time, I'll see you when I see you. If you like this video, please click the like button. If you want more content, click subscribe. If you click that little bell and click all, then you'll get more content notifications.